back to the symposium. We are now going to go into our one-to-one straight talk interview, where Kate Bulkley, media commentator and journalist, is in conversation with Christina Sulebeck, general manager of HBO Max EMEA. So welcome to all, welcome back. Lovely to see you, Kate and Christina. And please carry on with the session. Thank you.
It's great to be here. As Louise said, I'm Kate Bulkley. I'm an independent media commentator and journalist. And I'm here with Christina Sulebeck. So nice to be with you, Christina, even virtually. Nice to see you. How are you?
Thank you so much, Kate. It's wonderful to be here and good to see you again.
Good. Now, the audience, welcome to you. If you'd like to participate, we would love you to join in. Do that by putting questions in the Q&A box at the bottom of the Zoom screen, all right? And we'll try to get to them as we go. So if you can kind of listen to what we're talking about and put relevant questions in as we go, that would be great. We're going to start with content, just to give you a hint. So, Christina, I'm just going to jump right in. You've been in this job only since the beginning of the year, but you've been at HBO for, you know, 10 years. So you have a good perspective on what's going on with HBO Max. And of course, you've been running, you know, very fast to get this HBO Max launched across Europe. It's an era of competitive streaming media. We know that. Warner Media and HBO Max is not alone in wanting to build new revenue sources. One of the things we want to talk about is how you do that. It seems like every day there's yet another streaming launch across Europe, another content partnership is unveiled, new commissions are announced. So how is HBO Max as an SVOD service developing its brand in Europe, and in particular in relation to content? Let's talk about how important content is, and particularly exclusive content, to what you're trying to achieve with HBO Max.
Absolutely. I would say we launched our first streaming service, HBO Max, back in May last year in the States, in US, with a great success. And we also launched in 39 markets in Latin America and Caribbean this summer. So a full blown out of all the Latin America, of course, continent at once with HBO Max. Now we have launched back in October, 26th of October, in six additional countries in Europe, and that is just the beginning. We've launched in the Nordic territories, where we began the D2C streaming service HBO Nordic back a decade ago.
2012, I think it was.
Yeah, exactly. So it's a decade ago when I joined the company. So very successful business that we've been running over the last decade in the Nordic. But we changed that to HBO Max and broadened the scope. But also in HBO España. So we sunsetted that and launched HBO Max, and then also in Andorra. And naturally, that is just the beginning. So we're already committed to launch an additional 21 markets next year in Europe. And, wow. And we also have committed that we will, our intention is to be in 190 markets globally by 2026. So a very, very aggressive launch strategy to become a global product out there with a great content catalog that we will be discussing a lot today, our beloved IPs and, you know, bespoke strategy around content.
So clearly, I mean, we're going to get into distribution because that's obviously a huge push for you, the distribution you've talked about, the country launches. But let's start with content. I mean, one of the lessons we've learned with VOD and streaming services is that content rules. In other words, you have to have these tent poles, you have to have exclusivity, you have to have a way to stand out. So talk to me about how you're doing that, and in particular with your first, I think it's your first commission for Europe.
Yeah, I would say you're probably referencing Kamikaze, which is our first Danish show that I'm going to come back to in a moment, because I'm very happy to show a clip from that today as well. Definitely content is key here. We know that HBO has a long history of storytelling of content. And of course, HBO has been the subset of our foundation for years, but also the Warner Brothers slate, of course, the DCs, the Cartoon Network, really, really broadening the scope of the content catalog. This is the first time in our history that Warner Media is bringing together all the powerhouses within Warner Media on one streaming platform. So besides, of course, HBO as a tentpole storyteller when it comes to dramas, we also have Max Original, which is a new format that we have started to develop to get more female, more younger, more broad in our approach of storytelling. I would say a couple of examples is Gossip Girls or Flight Attendant, Raised by Wolves. Yeah. That is very more youth skewed and also more female skewed, but also definitely another beloved IP that I will come back to later, Just Like That, that premieres today, which is the spin-off of course, Sex and the City. And I would say the Cartoon Network is really important also to bring in and tie it all together, and the DC universe, all the comics that is very beloved. And of course, the theatrical releases that we have 45 days later now with the Warner Brothers slate. And I would say
you're jumping ahead a little bit. Let's talk a little bit about Kamikaze. So, Kamikaze, why did you commission this? Why did you commission a Danish drama first? I mean, talk about that and give us a view on how this looks like your commissioning strategy. In other words, are we going to see more Kamikaze? So cue up Kamikaze and tell me a little bit about why you did this.
Yeah, I would say Kamikaze is our first Danish production, but we've been producing for years in the Nordic region, both Norwegian and Swedish dramas before, just under the label HBO Nordic. We've also been producing in Central Eastern Europe for many, many years, and also with HBO Go, and of course in Spain on the HBO España. Kamikaze was the first Nordic show to come out on HBO Max. We also had two Spanish shows, Dolores and Vanikov Case, that came out when we launched as well. Well, both a scripted and an unscripted, but Kamikaze is a special one. It's our first Danish drama production. It is a very youth-skewed story that follows a young Danish blogger and very influential, rich young lady that unfortunately loses her family in a flight crash in the beginning, the opening scene of the show. So it's really about Julie finding her way back to life. And it's a very, very good way of opening the drama productions in Denmark, because it tells a really unique story about light and hope and finding the way back when everything looks very, very dark in life. And I would say that drama production coming in as our first Danish drama production is just setting a high bar, I would say, because we are committed to produce much, much more, both in Denmark, but naturally across all of our markets where we have a footprint. Local regional productions are really important to our slate. Absolutely, the Warner Brothers, the HBO slate, etc., is really, you know, all the Anglo-Saxon is really the fundamental of the platform. But bringing local voices, local talents close to our consumers is a really big commitment of ours.
I mean, I think that's the point. It's local voices and local commitment. Maybe now is a good time to run the clip. Would you like to do that?
Der et før og et efter i alt. Der var et før, hvor jeg tænkte på tiden som noget, der bragte mig nærmere, hvad jeg nu end så frem imod. Han er jo så pæn.
Don't be across me. Jeg vil egentlig også bare fortælle, at vi tager videre i dag.
Jeg sorgner dig. I've just gotta let you
know. Klokken 16:02 fik jeg en besked fra far. Nu. Efter. Crazy.
Jeg tror, du sidder her, fordi at du tænker, at jeg kan hjælpe dig.
Forkert. Jeg sidder her, fordi der er nogle andre, der har sagt, at det hjælper. Men der er jo ikke noget, der hjælper.
Where are you going?
I'm just flying.
Kære Gud.
Enten giver du mig lysten til at leve tilbage, eller også, så må du tage livet af mig, eller i det mindste sende nogen, der kan gøre det i dit sted.
Julia?
Hvordan min tur ender.
Wow, pretty powerful story.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. It's very,
so
very
powerful. How many Kamikazes are in the pipeline? I mean, what's your originals budget over the next 12 or 24 months? I mean, how much are you going to be spending on content in Europe?
We'll definitely be searching for the next Kamikaze, that's for sure, because I would say Kamikaze was not only popular in the country of original, which is Denmark, but Kamikaze was actually viewed equally much in Spain, in US and other places. So we did have a global launch strategy with Kamikaze to get it out because it's a universal story. And I would say looking for that next Kamikaze that has that travability and that ability to travel to global markets is really, really phenomenal. I will say that we do have a lot of commitment into regional. We're ramping up, but at the same time, we do want to find those specific and distinct stories. That's really important to us. So we're not just ramping up for the sake of getting more volume. We want to get the right volume, of course, and the right voices in there. So I would say our commitment is to produce 10 to 12 new dramas and equally many unscripted formats. One new thing for us is to invest more in unscripted. We don't have a legacy of that. We've been producing some true crime and some documentaries throughout the years. Very successfully, but now we're also broadening the scope on our unscripted formats. In the States, we're producing F-Boy Island, of course, a competition show, but also Selena and Chef and other formats that's more competitor or more food or lifestyle driven. So that's definitely also something you're going to see from us, both in the markets we already launched as well as new markets to come.
Right. Well, that's exciting. How did Kamikaze do? Can you give us any figures for viewing figures? How did it resonate with your audience?
Yeah, I would say definitely the way that we look at resonation and success criteria for shows that we're producing is naturally the existing customer base. How well is it perceived? How many is watching it? And I would say the good thing is we have the four episodes out there on the platform now. So we released the two episodes a week, but now it's come to an end, unfortunately, a good end. And I would say that, we do have the full tracking of that. We're getting into a 30 days release cadence to understand, of course, all the numbers. I will say that it really outperform our expectation, not only in home market, as I said, but also in other markets. But I would say also from, we also look at it as a sales driver. Does it drive engagement for new audiences onto the platform? Does it appeal to audiences that we haven't been speaking to before, who's coming back because there's new content on the platform? And we can definitely check all boxes on that. Kamikaze.
Right. Oh, that's good. So it drove new sales. You'd have new subscriptions off the back.
Absolutely.
Great.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
That's good. We'll get into subscribers in a minute, but let's keep talking about content. You have some really, HBO has some truly exceptional franchises. I mean, I'm thinking about Game of Thrones, The Sopranos, Harry Potter, Batman, Superman, Sex and the City. I mean, these are tentpole franchises, right? And you obviously have access to a lot of this stuff for your platform. But how do these spinoffs figure in your strategic rollout of HBO Max? How are you using them?
Absolutely. You mentioned all of them, right? I would say a lot of the big IPs here. So I'm very happy that you know them so well. And I would say
HBO is a big brand.
It is. And so is Warner Brothers and all the other great content coming together. So I would say we do have more than 100 years of storytelling. And as I mentioned in the beginning, it's the first time we're putting everything together. Sometimes I have to kind of like pinch my arm just to understand it's all on one platform, because it is really a lot of beloved content and strong IPs that is coming together and really doing the parade, for the audiences that we serve. And I would say having all of that temple strategy together and glued together is really important. But I also want to ping that third-party acquisition is a very, very vital part of our strategy still. And we are lucky that we're able to really bring great storytelling also from other big temple titles, Handmaid's Tale, Billions from Showtime, Hulu titles. Really important to add to the service. Also younger skewed content like Fear the Walking Dead and other great IPs that's been, hugely popular. The interesting part, Kate, is that audiences doesn't always really tune in on logos and brands. And if you ask people, Vikings, that must be, it's on HBO Nordic or HBO Max now, but you know, yeah, it's a History Channel show, right, that we license, but people will say it's an HBO show because it's on our service. So people are not always glued in on where the great content is coming from. They just really want to get that volume. They want to get the great IPs connected on one platform, so they have a lot to look at.
So your idea, when I say, you know, what's your, how do you do the strategic look at this? The idea is just to put as much up there as possible, as fast as possible. I mean, is that essentially how you're looking at it?
Yeah, I would say not as much and fast as possible. It is a very, very diligent process of curating the best content, of course. And I would say also handpicking titles. Definitely we want to have, you know, the house of Warner Media. We want to have that up on the service. And we have to remember that. I think we have 3,500 hours of library content just coming from Warner Brothers, you know,
right.
You know, amazing titles like Big Bang Theory and Friends, of course, but there's so much gold hidden down there. Of course, we want to have all of that on the platform. That's a question of getting the volume as well and some of those, you know, beloved characters back. But I would say the rest of it is really about, you know, quality and, you know, and curation over algorithm and just volume, right? Because it is great to have volume on the platform, but it also makes it very, very difficult to find content. So curation is really key for us as well.
Yeah. Let's talk about one of my favorite franchises, Sex and the City. I mean, come on. I mean, it's fantastic. And so now there's a spinoff, right? And Just Like That, I think is the name. I think you have a clip of that. Can you kind of cue that up for us? Why? When is this coming out? What's the plan with this? How important do you think it's going to be for your platform?
Exactly. I dressed up in pink today just in honor of that. It's actually the premiere
today. But what shoes are you wearing? Don't show me.
No. I'm barefoot today, but I wish I would have, later on, I would definitely do that when I'm sitting in front of the telly and watching it. And I will, you know, the premiere is today. I'm really, really excited. You know, of course, growing up with the ladies and finally seeing them back where they belong on our screen. And I'm very, very thrilled about that. I don't have a lot of spoilers because even though I might sit in a very prominent position, I'm not so prominent that I get to see everything when it comes to Game of Thrones or other strong IPs, unfortunately. Neither do I have time, unfortunately. So I'm still watching it together with you and the rest of the people out there. But I will say it is a spin-off. It's something we've been working on for a quite long time, I would say. You know, naturally, Game of Thrones and Sex and the City and Sopranos, etc., is really some of our biggest, strongest IPs. And as much as we can put that to life, we want to do that. So
will you do the same thing? Will you do the same thing with Kamikaze? Will you send it out week by week, or are you just going to put it on the platform all at the same time?
I would say a lot of our, you know, the US slate naturally follows the US launch strategy, right? So I will not be able to put on two episodes of Just Like That tonight, even though I wish we could do that. I have to follow, of course, the US strategy. But when it comes to original programming that we produce in HBO Max in Europe, we are the ones setting the strategy for how we release it. So if we want to do a binge watch, or if we want to do one episode a week or a day or whatever we want to do, we really evaluate the importance of also getting into the storyline, the characters, what is the best cadence. And of course, we also have something that's called, you know, customer lifetime value that we pressure, you know, like put a lot of efforts behind. So,
this one's being driven by the US. So, And Just Like That will be just put on as a binge watch from today, I guess. Yeah.
So it's coming up today, and we do have a clip with us. So we're very excited to show that.
The more I live, the more I find that if you have good friends in your corner, anything's possible.
Carrie, party of three?
The future is unwritten because we're all at different stages of life.
Tonight, bring your A game.
How many dating apps are you on?
I'm just waiting for someone to create a dating site that's called Here's the Man You've Been Searching For, Seema.
This is X, Y, and Me. What about you, Carrie? Have you ever masturbated in a public place?
Not since Barney's closed.
Well, honey, I'm home.
I remember when you kept your sweaters in the stove.
Higher, your
There are always going to be roads not taken.
So you can't have it all?
No, you can. It's just really hard.
You're not happy with who you are? Step out of that box and change!
And just like that, after all the years and all the changes, you're still you. Hello, lovers.
Higher, your love is set me free.
That looks great. I definitely want to watch.
Me too.
All right. So we've talked a lot about content. You mentioned that you're obviously going to have the Warner Brothers films on. I know there's been a little bit of controversy about the windowing for that. I think we're back to, instead of 90s, to be 45, but it's going to be a case-by-case basis, right, Christina? I mean, that's essentially what's going to happen.
I would say, Kate, that there's been a lot of writing about it. In US, they did choose one strategy to have a day and date with the theatrical releases, all of 21. That has never been discussed for the international market. And that was a reaction, of course, of the pandemic that they were going through, or we're still going through. Now in international markets and also in US starting next year, we have agreed that we have a 45-day window strategy. 45 days window, 6 week is, you know, gives enough effort for the cinemas also to really promote and also sell the box ticket office, you know, that is equally important for us at Warner Media. And I would say also what we have a very clear agreement that we are not starting to position or promote or talk about the movies as long as they are in the cinemas. And we'll not do that before closer to our 45-day window. And I think that's okay. A good strategy when it comes to titles like Dune and you know, other great titles. And one could always argue and say some movies are so big they will stay in cinemas for a very long time and others would go off very quickly. But we also need to be able to have a strategy that is, you know, applied for all the movies so we know how to promote and how to take advantage of those very strong IPs for us.
Right. Okay. Let's pivot a little bit now and talk about distribution and how you drive subscriber uptake. You know, you mentioned that Kamikaze had helped drive some subscriber uptake, but obviously one of the big levers you have is not just content, you have pricing. And you also have bundling, and you also have how you work with partners and platforms. So talk a little bit about that. I mean, you know, the big conversation now in the industry is, do you do direct to consumer only? Do you still work with some of these, what we might call legacy platforms, or not? So talk to us a little bit about your strategy on that.
Absolutely. I would say our strategy for Europe with HBO Europe and now with HBO Max and also globally has always been to work with very strong partnership when it comes to wholesale distribution. We do have a legacy of very strong relationship with cable, IPTV, mobile, DTH, you know, across the board, I would say, also with in our European business. So we do have both exclusive and non-exclusive relationships, depending on the market. And we'll continue to really fuel that as we grow into new markets as well. So we're very, very open for partnership and different bundles and packaging, because we cater to different needs, you know, in the industry. And I would say another thing is also we do want to have and we do want to grow the D2C presence and the direct to consumer, the relationship with our clients. It's very important for us and part of our strategy. But it is also to really be on all platforms when it comes to hardwares as well and IAP. So for instance, we just launched now when we launched HBO Max in the six first European markets, we also launched together with Google, you know, Android, but also with Apple IAP. And it's really important for us that the consumers have the ability to sign up, whether it's through cable, IPTV, you know, as well as the app stores or directly on the .com. So all those different, you know, distribution channels are equally important for our strategy, and we'll continue to really work and you know, develop our partnership models.
So two questions on that. One is, you know, in three rather key markets in Europe, you have long-term deals with Sky for them to have your content. So you can't launch your D2C product in the UK, you can't launch it in Germany, and you can't launch it in Italy for at least 2 or 3 years now. So how much of a problem is that? Is that something you're going to address and try to fix? Or do you just sort of play out those output deals and don't launch your D2C product until later in life?
Yeah, I would say, I mentioned we launched in 39 markets, like a magic wand, right? In Latin America and Caribbean. So that was because we did not tie in with any other outputs. So we had that clean slate. In Europe, yeah. And Europe being a very, very prominent market for WarnerMedia in general and our strategy, of course, we've had very, very strong partnership models over here. Sky is a good example, and we're very happy about our partnership with Sky. They've been helping us really drive the viewership and drive the consumption of HBO for many, many, many years, and is a very valuable partner of ours. I would say the same was the case for many others where we also launched a D2C service, and we will launch next year also where we have, of course, a lot of partnership models in place. But our strategy is really to go, you know, to go global and have a D2C presence over time. So we're evaluating market by market when license comes up for renewal, but also when we feel that our roadmap is capable to handle more launches. And we're launching in 21 countries next year, just in Europe. So you can imagine how our roadmap is being fueled up. So really Europe is big, and there's a lot to come there, and we definitely have a strategy to be in all the markets over time, but it is really a staggered approach when it comes to launching in new markets.
Right, and the new markets, in other words, basically for the big ones, the UK, Germany, and Italy, you'll just wait until those run out, or are you going to try to renegotiate that?
No, I would say the Sky markets, as you mentioned, we do have a deal that runs for many years to come, and we will evaluate whether we want to launch in those markets, when we want to launch, and with what model we would launch. Okay. Hopefully with the Sky Corporation or this means, right? So exactly. there's many ways of doing this. I would say, again, we tie in a lot with our wholesale distribution partners. Yeah. We have Vodafone exclusively in both Portugal and in Spain, where we are already present. Yeah. And I would say we really look at those partnership models and value them highly.
Yeah, no, I mean, I think that in some ways that's the way forward. I mean, I was just looking at what Viacom CBS is doing. They just announced a 50-50 joint venture with Sky called Sky Showtime, and that's going to move their D2C into markets that, you know, they couldn't really get to as fast. I mean, Bob Bakish actually said at one point, we wouldn't have launched in some of those markets for 2 or 3 years. We didn't have the manpower, woman power to do it, basically.
Absolutely.
So they're working with Sky. So, I mean, I think that probably we'll see more of those kind of things from you guys as well. I mean, you've got Vodafone, but there might be some other ones, right?
Absolutely. And I would say market by market, right? We evaluate business opportunities in different markets, whether it is, you know, partnership models, as you referred to, or whether it is with other kind of partnerships. We've had very strong tie-ins also with Apple in the States, etc. So there are many ways of partnering up here. We're very open and welcoming those different solutions depending on the market, because Europe is very complex in that nature, that one doesn't fit, you know, like a full rollout, and the distribution and the partnership model is very, very complex, as you know very well.
I do. So you didn't mention pricing. Are you going to do sort of creative pricing, you know, sort of premium models and things like that? Or what's your plan on that? Or are you going to stick with a...
Yeah, I love that you call it creative pricing. It is definitely creative pricing, but I would say also behind creative pricing is also a lot of data, of course. So the way that we work with pricing is we evaluate pricing per market naturally. So we do a lot of understanding about the market mechanics and the audiences in different markets before we apply a strategy. When we launched in Nordic, we actually decided to reduce prices, which was probably a very big surprise for people, that we're reducing prices and we're adding a lot more volume and value to the proposition. And we also launched with a yearly plan at a discounted price of 33%. And also with a launch promotion, the first month for new customers coming onto the platform for half price for life. I would say a similar...
That's nice.
That
half
was
price
very
for
nice.
Life. I like that offer.
it's a very, very good offer. Absolutely. And I would say a very, very, very strong proposition and very clear message. And I would say that was probably the most aggressive one we launched in the Nordic region. In Spain, we had an equally, good price strategy there. We did not decrease prices. We kept prices, but we also had a launch promotion similar to Nordic. And I would say as we are entering into Central Eastern Europe now in Portugal, we will also have a present and a very, very significant business in place today. We are naturally evaluating that. And of course, also into new markets like Turkey, Greece, Netherlands, etc.
Right. So how fast are the subs growing? I mean, I remember at the end of, I think it was the Q3 numbers, AT&T, which of course owns WarnerMedia, which of course owns HBO Max at the moment, said you had about 70 million subscribers to HBO Max at the end of Q3. So where are we now, and is how fast is Europe growing in the subscriber base? If you can't talk to me globally, what's happening on the European basis?
Yeah, definitely. And I can talk to you more globally than on the European basis.
Okay, sorry.
No. No, but you're always welcome to ask. And I would say definitely on the HBO site and in general globally, we have been in a more stagnated subscriber growth. We needed something to fuel the growth, and HBO Max was definitely the answer. So we launched back in May last year, as I mentioned. And definitely we have, you know, like we've been up 12.5 million year over year, thanks to the strong international. I would say international has been driving a lot of that for us. Latin America and now also Europe. And I would say also thanks to the AVOD proposition that we launched in US back in summer as well. I think it was around May time. So now we are at 24.4 million subscribers outside of the US, and we're growing fast. I would say those are the latest numbers of reference. And of course, we're growing by the minute as we just launched in Nordic and Spain as well.
Great. I mean, it sounds like a strong growth. As you say, are you going to launch the AVOD product in Europe? Is there a plan for that, a roadmap, or not yet?
So I would say it's being discussed, and we'll always evaluate it. But the plan is not to launch AVOD in our existing markets anytime soon. It might be in expansion markets to come. I would say, of course, AVOD is a very attractive product in US, where the retail price is a significant higher than it is in our markets. So yes, we have had more flexibility to, as I mentioned, to play with prices and be more creative, as you mentioned. and because of that, we haven't had the same needs to go in and create an AVOD component that actually was a price discriminator in terms of advertising. So, exactly. But it might come in new markets.
I just want to remind the audience, if you have questions, please put them in the Q&A box, because I don't see any at the moment, but I am looking. So if you have a question, please send it to us, and I will try to ask it of Christina. Christina, we've talked about a lot. We haven't talked about what I would call the big elephant in the room, which is the $43 billion merger of WarnerMedia and Discovery into Warner Brothers Discovery. I love that new name, Warner Brothers Discovery. What can you tell us about the impact this will have on HBO Max? Now, I know the deal isn't closed yet, but it seems like everyone's moving in that direction. I know that David Zaslav, who runs Discovery and will be the head of the new combined company, is giving interviews and talking about it. So I think it's going to happen, barring any regulatory snafus. So what do you think is going to be the impact on HBO Max in your markets in particular?
Yeah, there's not much I can talk about or that I know about the merger either. I would say, of course, it's being kept on a much higher level than where I'm sitting at this point. And I would say definitely there's a lot of movement in the organization, but we're staying razor sharp because the strategy is streaming. And I think John Stankey has been very, very clear in all his communication about the growth and the perspective in the future is streaming. And I don't see any forthcoming changes towards that strategy, because definitely it has been a strategy also for Discovery for years. And it has naturally been our number one priority over the years. And I would say combining those muscles also with sport is definitely compelling. We do have some experience launching sports on our platform in Latin America, where we had the Champions League. So we do have really, some examples of what sport can do in combination with HBO Max from Brazil and Mexico, which has been very, very appealing for us. So I'm looking very much forward to whatever might come. But I would say I'm staying very razor sharp focused on the strategy, which is bringing HBO Max global.
Yeah. I mean, there's some big questions. You've already mentioned them. One is whether there'll be distinct D2C offers. In other words, will HBO Max still be a distinct offer and Discovery Plus another offer with the Eurosport in it, or will they be one big offer? I think the, you know, what David Zaslav is sort of saying is he thinks it's going to be one big bundle, but who knows? And sport, as you say, I mean, it's a fascinating, it would be a fascinating addition. And as you say, you've seen good results in LATAM with putting sports. So, you know, it seems like it might do that. The other thing that I think is interesting is Kevin Mayer, who you may remember, former Disney exec, he launched Disney Plus. He's now chair of DAZN, which of course is a sporting streaming company. He's been hired as a consultant on the Warner Brothers Discovery D2C strategy. So, I mean, I assume you haven't met him yet, but he'll have some views. Have you talked to? No, they haven't talked to you about this yet. No, not yet. Okay, fine.
You know, Kate, you know more than I do. You know, we read the same articles. We hear the same noise. It's going to be amazing. But I would say this year for me, it's been all about launch, right? I've been so deep dive into plans and roadmaps and operation and just lighting up HBO Max. So really, I've been staying very focused, and so has the team. And I think that's quite good when there's noise in the corridors about what will happen in the future, just to stay very, very sharp on the strategy, which is getting HBO Max out there. So,
And as you said, it's not really going to change. I mean, John Stankey, who runs AT&T, has said, you know, D2C is the future.
Absolutely.
I think David believes that too. So you're doing the right thing. So I'm sure it'll be great. I do have some questions now. So here's a question from the audience. RTL just announced a super app in DE, that must be Denmark, right? Including audiobooks and music powered by Deezer. Ooh, is this where you see the market going for all over-the-top or streaming services? Can you answer that?
So more bundled, I guess that's...
I think it's a bundled thing. It's like a super app, right?
Yeah.
You can have audiobooks, music.
Oh, definitely. I would say the way, maybe it was Denmark, maybe it was Germany, but I would say the way that those bundles, the super bundles are coming alive today, I see a lot of those examples at telcos and other places where they're really combining, you know, podcast, music services, streaming services, you know, those super offers are very, very compelling. And I do understand as an audience or a consumer, it's very, very attractive to go in and get a bundle where you can get, you know, like a vast majority of the content you like. So I definitely think that is an interesting approach. I would say we have the Warner Brothers, we have the theatrical, as we mentioned, we have news from CNN, we do have the kids component, as we mentioned, we do have all of those super brands coming together now with HBO Max. We also have games in our kids universe. Could we add games to our service?
Like
I probably
Netflix
need to ask
has.
Somebody before I answer, but I would say yes, why not? I would love to see gamification coming alive on our platform.
Yeah.
I would
love
to see Harry Potter games and, you know, like and other features also being available for the authors. So I would say those super authors, if you call it that, and you know, music and all of that combined for making those great offers at a discounted price for consumers. I think that's a strategy forward, and definitely something that will be looked much more upon also from our side.
No, I totally agree with you. I mean, if Netflix can do it with Stranger Things games, I think you can do it with Harry Potter. That you probably have more luck. Harry Potter's a bigger brand. Okay, here's another one. What does the focus on streaming mean for the other legacy businesses, i.e. linear? As you know, Disney has shut down their linear channels in many markets. Are you going to close down your linear channels? Like, I don't know, Cartoon, Boomerang, those kind of linear channels.
Just want to mention that within HBO Europe, we actually have linear channels. So in Central Eastern Europe, where we launched back in 1991, I think that was our first business outside of the States. We launched a long range of linear channels. So in Central Eastern Europe, we're still running our HBO, our Cinemax, our different branded channels, our linear channels. When we launched in the Nordic and in Spain, in Nordic, actually, interesting enough, 10 years ago, we launched with one linear channel because the demand in the market was to have linear still and then an SVOD on the side. we quickly figured out 1 year into launch that nobody was really interested in our linear channels. There was no consumption. Even our MVDPs has been screaming for linear channel. We're not really interested in carrying it anymore. So we decided to sunset that channel and only have an SVOD component. So when we launched in Spain, and also when we launched in Portugal, we decided not to go with linear channels. I will say that our combination of the model we run in Central Eastern Europe today with HBO Go, which is our SVOD component, is also that we offer all our linear base, which is a significant base that we carry in Central Eastern Europe. We offer them, all of them, HBO Go today, authenticated. So they have access to HBO Go and the linear channel combined in their offer. So that is a really important part of our strategy. So we also carry some linear channels, for instance, in Poland, on our SVOD platform, HBO Go. Mm. And we'll continue to do that as we become HBO Max. But I think the question is also diverting to TNT and to, you know, Cartoon Network and some of other other sister channels. It's not really in my remit to comment on. And I think they are very successful depending on the market they operate. So I would say that I don't see any necessity to close that down any of that. It's really a question about demands in market. But definitely okay, on the okay. streaming side, we'll not be launching a lot of linear channels in the future, that's for sure.
Right, that makes sense. There's always that question of, you know, when do you shut down a linear channel and when do you take that content and just put it on demand? So that's as you say, it'll be a market by market approach. There's a question here. You walked away from an Amazon channels deal in the US. Why did you do that? And what does it say about how you want to work with partners? I know that you did that in the US. I don't know what you've done with in Europe. I know you're working with, I don't know if you're working with Amazon channels, are you?
No, we never did. And I would say definitely that's US centric. It was in US, we had that a cooperation with Amazon for years. And of course there was a lot of writing about that and how would we dare to walk away for such a strong relationship? You know, I think that the strategy has been very clear again. We want to have a direct relationship with our audiences. It's very important to be able to fuel that that growth story in the years to come. And I would say Amazon was just one specific example. I mentioned it before. We're very, very happy to work with partnerships like Apple, you know, with Google, with Samsung's and the game consoles, etc. And we also do in-app purchase through their channels in their app stores and really, you know, where we have the ability to really expose our content and drive consumption to their platforms as well. But the Amazon model was very different in the context of the relationship. And in US, they walked away from that agreement. In Europe, we did not have that agreement. So not much more to comment on for Europe.
Okay, so you're not going to work with Amazon channels at the moment, it sounds like, right?
No plans.
No plans. Okay, good. Are there any strategic plans for FAST channels? And I think you've answered that because FAST channels are advertiser-funded channels. I think you've said you're not planning on doing that in the near future, right?
Yeah, I would say FAST channels versus AVOD, paid AVOD is of course different. But I don't have anything in my roadmap right now, but many things can still happen in 22 and 23. So I will refer from committing anything around that, but no plans right now.
Okay, and this is like, we're going to the end here. This is looks like a good question. It says, hi, I'd love to hear your thoughts on a potential launch in the French market. So when is France on the roadmap? And what are the hurdles for that?
As I mentioned with Sky, Orange is a very strong partner of ours in France and has been for many, many years with OCS. That's been a very successful partnership model. We always evaluate new markets. Right now, my head is spinning around 21 markets in next year. So it's not going to be that long Christmas break from me and the team, unfortunately. But you know, it's all about 22 and getting that lined up. But yes, we are investigating and looking into France as we speak. We have hired a commissioning editor in France who has just started looking for projects for us.
And great.
Really tapping into that, because we know that in France it's so important with that local relevancy, and really French content is you know, besides being amazing, it is also very, very important for the audiences in that market. So I would say we're just starting to look into it, but there's no decision, no communications about any potential launch in France, but definitely we'll be coming back to you, Kate, and all of the audiences later with more information about that.
That sounds great. Well, listen, we're running up against our time here. We've only got a minute left, so I think we should wrap it up. This has been fantastically interesting. Thank you so much for being with us, Christina. I want to thank the audience for joining us. I want to thank CTAM Europe, obviously, for hosting us. I want to thank the tech team for making it work. Thank you very much, Peter and his team. And of course, I want to thank you, Christina, for sharing your thoughts on all of this. We're going to have a short break now, I'm told. And then there's the AVOD Fast Panel is next. Thank you so much for being with us. And thank you, Christina. Okay. Bye-bye.
Bye.